Just look at all these masks. Some represent deities, others animals. A grinning mask. The mask of a wicked fox spirit. Japanese masks are very diverse. Since the old days, people in Japan have put on masks and danced to pray for a good harvest. In the world of traditional performing arts, masks are essential props that are passed down for generations. The history of masks in Japan dates back almost 2,000 years. Japanese masks are subtle and expressive, the products of exquisite craftsmanship. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we look at masks, whose timeless power to fascinate is deeply woven into the fabric of Japanese life.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Our theme for this week is masks, and I'm in Kyoto, where the first masks were made for the traditional no theater. The fantasy appeal of turning yourself into someone else runs deep in human nature, and a mask is something that can give you a new identity almost immediately. It can even transform you into something supernatural or superhuman. But today we're not going to be looking at superhero masks, rather the traditional Japanese masks that have been part of the culture here for hundreds of years.
Every community in Japan has festivals, and these frequently involve masks. People put on masks of deities or demons and dance to pray for a good harvest. The city of Hamada in Shimane Prefecture, Western Japan, is home to a festival with a long history. This dance is performed in thanksgiving for the bountiful blessings of the deities. The dancers conjure up a dazzling world of myth and magic. Many different gods and goddesses entertain the audience and draw them into the story that's presented. Ebisu, the god of prosperity in trade and business. Also considered the god of fishing, Ebisu is a popular object of worship. The bright colors of his mask emphasize his broad grin. Susanoo no Mikoto. This deity is said to have defeated the mythical eight-headed serpent. With his glaring eyes and clenched teeth, he looks pretty ferocious. The mask of a fox spirit. A troublemaker. In Japan, foxes are traditionally believed to possess supernatural powers. A Chinese god, Shorky, drives away demons. The mask conveys Shorky's strength and his dignity. Here is one of Shorky's victims, a spirit that brings sickness. What is good and what is evil? The masks make the distinction clear. In ancient Japan, people believed in a multitude of different deities, and many of them can still be seen at Japanese festivals. These friendly-looking characters are Hyotoko and Okami. They have been familiar faces at festivals for centuries. In parts of Japan, Hyotoko is a god of fire. He breathes flames through his puckered mouth. This plump, happy woman is Okami. She is a deity of good fortune. As soon as a mask is in place, a skillful performer can reveal its powers of communication. Daikokuten, a god who brings wealth. With deft use of the arms and hands, the wearer brings the mask to life. These graceful movements can captivate the viewer. If something is supposed to be hilarious, then you have to show that clearly, without speaking. You have to feel that yourself. Your body has to move in unison with the mask. In the world of Japan's traditional performing arts, masks play a crucial role. In No, the full range of human emotions is expressed through dance. An actor uses minimal, high-precision movements to convey subtle shifts in mental state. This is made possible by delicate crafting of the No mask. No makes use of various female masks. Young women, fearsome crones, pure celestial maidens. There are more than 20 kinds of female mask, each made for a specific character type. This mask represents a young woman. Look closely and you can see that the left and right sides are not exactly the same. The nostril on the right side is slightly lower, and the area around the mouth is clearly shaped. The nostril on the left flares up, and the area below the cheek is slightly different. The two sides of the face are subtly differentiated to let the performer express both the woman's strength and charm. And if you change the angle of the No mask, again its expression will change. Head on, the expression is relatively neutral, but tilting the chin up makes the face seem happier. And when the chin is lowered, the face appears sadder. Such slight movements can make the eyes convey very different frames of mind. Whether at a festival or on the stage, there are literally so many faces to Japanese masks.
I'm in the Arashiyama area of Kyoto now, which is a popular tourist spot. This shop here specializes in bamboo products. They have some pretty interesting masks inside as well, so let's go in and take a look. These masks are known as Saga masks, Saga being the name of this district of Kyoto, and these masks have been made here for hundreds of years now. Let's take a look at one. This is Ebisu, who's one of the seven lucky gods. These masks, they're very light. They're made out of numerous layers of Japanese paper. And you can see this one is using the pages of an old book, a bodhisattva. And this one is for harmony in the family. The brown one next to him with the beard, literally, hyakusai, it's 100 years old. And this one, as you might expect, is to bring longevity. And again, this rather interesting looking one here, it's a crow goblin, that's how it translates into English anyway. And that's to ward off the perils of fire. These masks are not meant to be worn on the face. They're for hanging on the wall, not as decoration, but Japanese people use them as talismans. Let's go on now and take a look at how masks are made, and we'll use a No mask as an example.
Fukuchiyama, Kyoto. Hori Yasuemon is a maker of No masks. First, he uses a chisel to rough out the face from a block of wood. No masks are usually made from hinoki, a type of cypress. Hinoki is easy to work and resists warping. Before it's carved, the wood is dried thoroughly. This takes years. A No mask must be able to express a subtle shift in a character's frame of mind. For this, the eyes are crucial. The surface of the eyes and the pupils are carved deep. The upper and lower eyelids protrude. Thicker eyelids deepen the shadows falling on the eyes. Then it's easier to make the face look happy from one angle and sad from another. If the carver makes even the slightest error, the expression of the mask may be irreversibly altered. A skillful craftsman can breathe life into a mask. After the mask has been shaped, color is applied. One difficult task is to strike the right balance between the black lines of the eyes and hair and the pale tone of the skin. To achieve a deep black, India ink is mixed with aged soot. The red of the lipstick is given a tinge of blue to help the lips blend with the surrounding skin. Once a color has been applied, it's scraped with a bamboo tool, then applied again. This makes the color look more natural. The skin tone is created by applying several coats of paint over a period of a week. The pigments have been aged for 3 or 4 years and have soot added to them. This helps to create a color with depth. The maker of a no mask uses a variety of traditional techniques to endow the mask with the power to reflect subtle shades of human emotion. One moment, brimming with anticipation. The next, shy and self-conscious.
This time I've come to a neighborhood called Higashiyama, which is well known for its antique shops. But I've actually come to visit a lady who makes no masks, who lives in this house here. So let's go straight in. Hello.
These are male masks on this side here and female masks on that side. You can tell them apart by looking at their hair. Female masks have their hair parted in the middle. These look very similar, but there are subtle differences. For instance, this is a girl 15 or 16 years old. And this one, a young woman between about 20 and 22 years old. And here, about the same age, but this one is a goddess. The lips are a little different. The lips on the other mask make her seem like she's smiling, but not so much on this mask here. This one's called Yamamba. She's an ogress who lives in the mountains. She's not a human being, so she has metal fittings in the eyes. And this is a Hannya mask. It represents a jealous female demon. A woman was so jealous, her face became like this.
I mean, they're all very realistic. This one particularly almost looks like he's alive.
This is Yase Otoko, an emaciated man. He's the ghost of someone who died with an unresolved grudge.
Depending on the angle you look at them from, they do really have very different expressions. This man here looks quite different.
Yes, it will vary depending on the angle.
If you say in Japanese that someone has a face like a no mask, it means that they're expressionless, but the expression really is down to the skill of the actor wearing the mask. Let's move on now and take a look at the history of masks in Japan.
Agricultural customs are deeply ingrained in Japanese culture. In ancient times, these customs gave rise to a variety of rituals and festivals, occasions to pray for and to give thanks for an abundant harvest. The harvest each year is greatly influenced by the weather. Accordingly, people appeal to the gods for good weather to grow rice. Many Japanese deities have strikingly human characteristics. By wearing various masks on religious occasions, people can assume the role of specific deities and dispense blessings. In Japan, masks date back almost 2,000 years. This is the Makimuku archaeological site in Nara Prefecture, western Japan. A mask excavated here is the earliest known wooden mask in Japanese history. It was carved out of a type of oak in the first half of the 3rd century. Scholars think it was used in rituals to avert disaster and to boost the harvest. Later, more sophisticated masks came to Japan from China. The collection of the Shosoin, Japan's preeminent treasure house in Nara, has masks dating back to the 8th century. This Paulownia wood mask would have been used by a child leading a lion in a lion dance. The expression is full of joy and vitality. From traces of pigment found on the lips and the tip of the nose, scholars have concluded that the face was originally covered in paint. This mask of a man's face is called Taikofu. He's a solitary old man with no family. The deep wrinkles on the forehead symbolize loneliness. Bugaku was a form of entertainment enjoyed at the imperial court 1,000 years ago. A performing art transmitted from China, Bugaku was frequently presented as an accompaniment to rituals. During the period of Chinese history called the Southern and Northern Dynasties, there lived a prince called Lan Ling. In battle, he would hide his beautiful face by wearing a fearsome mask surmounted by a dragon. His aim was to strengthen the resolve of his troops. The mask of Prince Lan Ling spread from Japan's imperial court to every corner of the land. In China, the dragon had the power to call up storm clouds and tempests. In Japan, it was associated mainly with plentiful rainfall. And that's why in many Japanese villages, masks of Prince Lan Ling came to be used in rituals where people pray for rain. A custom also developed of putting on masks and performing a dance, accompanied by taiko drums and flutes, when it was time to plant rice seedlings. The use of masks on these occasions is documented in picture scrolls. The No Theatre was synthesized from various performing arts in different parts of Japan. Zayami, the man who gave No a distinct identity, refined popular performance traditions into a sophisticated form of entertainment for warlords and the nobility. Color schemes fine-tuned in Japanese painting since the Heian period. Carving techniques developed in the Kamakura period. These were among the traditions harnessed to perfect No masks in the 16th century. Masks, first carved to assist in ancient harvest prayers, were refined over the centuries and eventually became a key element in one of Japan's classic performing arts.
Masks are not just a way to assume a role. In Japan, a mask is sacred and it can bring a character to life. But if a No actor fails to become one with his mask, it will have no dramatic impact. The connection is almost mystical, and No actors are extremely careful never to let anyone touch their masks. Many masks are treasured to this day. Next, we're going to take a look at some completely different kinds of masks. This is a story about some people on a small island in western Japan and their efforts to keep alive a mask tradition in their community.
Okinoshima is part of Shimane Prefecture in western Japan. Far offshore in the Sea of Japan, this island has a rich cultural and archaeological heritage. But not long ago, it was hit by tragedy. Oh! the main hall of the temple Kokubunji burned to the ground. This is a performance of Renge Emai. This dance dates back 1,000 years, and it can only be seen on Okinoshima. Many of the masks used in the dance were destroyed in the fire. The entire history of Renge Emai, everything destroyed. Gone. We lost it all in just moments. This dance was part of the community's identity. The people of the island rose to the challenge of protecting their precious tradition. One man in particular was determined to restore every single lost mask. Hideo Murakami, chairman of the Renge Emai Preservation Committee. My only thought, as a participant in Renge Emai, was we cannot allow this art form to vanish. How could we possibly let it perish in our generation? After all these years, how could we? Murakami began to remake all the masks himself. He used to work as a hospital administrator, but he knew how to carve a mask. His father, Katsuo Murakami, had dedicated his life to sustaining the dance, and it was from him that Hideo had learned how to bring a mask to life. In his garage, Murakami works away in silence. 9 masks were lost. Their replacements must be completed in time for the performance in the coming spring. Murakami spends 8 hours a day working on the masks. He has a liver ailment, and at times the work is so exhausting that he collapses into a deep slumber. Murakami also teaches the local children how to perform the dance. Most of them will leave the island when they get older. Murakami wants to give them pride in their community by fostering a love for this folk dance. A problem has cropped up in the course of making the masks. Murakami can't get hold of a piece of wood large enough and sturdy enough to make the lion's head mask, a very important mask that protects against evil. There's not much time, but for now, Murakami presses on with the other masks and hopes for the best. Two months later, Murakami gets some great news from a local man who is preparing to rebuild his house. He plans to use paulownia wood and has agreed to let Murakami have some for the carving of the lion's head. It's a thick paulownia log, more than 60 centimeters across. Perfect for making the mask. Murakami gets straight down to work on the lion's head mask. The overall shape of the mask has been roughed out. But then Murakami notices that a mistake has been made. I may have carved it too much. He has carved the nose down a bit too far. The nose is very important for expressing the lion's dignity. Replacing all the lost masks was a serious challenge in the first place. And yet, Murakami took it on in spite of illness. What should he do now? Compromise so as to be ready for the festival, or take time to redo the mask and risk being late? A after 10 days of agonizing, Murakami decides to redo the nose of the lion. The lion's head mask will be used for decades to come. The proper shape must be handed down to the next generation. He decides to use an old technique. He cuts away the sides of the nose and glues in square wooden plugs. Then he will be able to re-carve it. The plug wood must fuse seamlessly with the nose. Once he's confirmed that it does, Murakami shapes the nose once more. Time is short, but he works with great care. Eight months after the fire, all nine of the lost masks have been remade. No more sleepless nights for me. It's such a relief. Sadly, though, in spite of all his hard work and dedication, Murakami did not live to see the revival of Renge Emai. He died just 1 week before the performance. In April, amid cherry blossoms in full bloom, the stage for the Renge Emai is prepared. The traditional dance, preserved for a millennium, is performed once again on the island. The dancers wear the masks into which Murakami had poured his heart and soul. The lion's head mask is just as proud as it should be. Now that the islanders have the masks, the dance can go on.
In Japan, masks have been handed down from generation to generation, along with the performing arts and religious customs in which they're used. Masks are essential to these aspects of Japanese culture, and without them, the traditions and beliefs would probably die out. The masks that we've seen on today's program are regarded as sacred objects, and that's why Mr. Murakami was so intent on recreating them that they took priority over any considerations for his own health. As we've seen, a mask is not simply a mask. Each one contains the spirit of the performers who've used it and the person who made it. And that spirit lives on in communities all over Japan. I'll see you again next time.
Next time we look at Satoyama, where the world of humans meets the world of nature in the Japanese countryside.
I'm in the Arashiyama area of Kyoto now, which is a popular tourist spot. This shop here specializes in bamboo products. They have some pretty interesting masks inside as well, so let's go in and take a look. These masks are known as Saga masks, Saga being the name of this district of Kyoto, and these masks have been made here for hundreds of years now. Let's take a look at one. This is Ebisu, who's one of the seven lucky gods. These masks, they're very light. They're made out of numerous layers of Japanese paper. And you can see this one is using the pages of an old book, a bodhisattva. And this one is for harmony in the family. The brown one next to him with the beard, literally, hyakusai, it's 100 years old. And this one, as you might expect, is to bring longevity. And again, this rather interesting looking one here, it's a crow goblin, that's how it translates into English anyway. And that's to ward off the perils of fire. These masks are not meant to be worn on the face, they're for hanging on the wall, not as decoration, but Japanese people use them as talismans. Let's go on now and take a look at how masks are made, and we'll use a gnaw mask as an example.
Fukuchiyama, Kyoto. Hori Yasuemon is a maker of gnaw masks. First, he uses a chisel to rough out the face from a block of wood. Gnaw masks are usually made from hinoki, a type of cypress. Hinoki is easy to work and resists warping. Before it's carved, the wood is dried thoroughly. This takes years. A gnaw mask must be able to express a subtle shift in a character's frame of mind. For this, the eyes are crucial. The surface of the eyes and the pupils are carved deep. The upper and lower eyelids protrude. Thicker eyelids deepen the shadows falling on the eyes. Then it's easier to make the face look happy from one angle and sad from another. If the carver makes even the slightest error, the expression of the mask may be irreversibly altered. A skillful craftsman can breathe life into a mask. After the mask has been shaped, color is applied. One difficult task is to strike the right balance between the black lines of the eyes and hair and the pale tone of the skin. To achieve a deep black, India ink is mixed with aged soot. The red of the lipstick is given a tinge of blue to help the lips blend with the surrounding skin. Once a color has been applied, it's scraped with a bamboo tool, then applied again. This makes the color look more natural. A Chinese god, Shorky, drives away demons. The mask conveys Shorky's strength and his dignity. Here is one of Shorky's victims, a spirit that brings sickness. What is good and what is evil? The masks make the distinction clear. In ancient Japan, people believed in a multitude of different deities, and many of them can still be seen at Japanese festivals. These friendly-looking characters are Hyotoko and Okami. They have been familiar faces at festivals for centuries. In parts of Japan, Hyotoko is a god of fire. He breathes flames through his puckered mouth. This plump, happy woman is Okami. She is a deity of good fortune. As soon as a mask is in place, a skillful performer can reveal its powers of communication. Daikokuten, a god who brings wealth. With deft use of the arms and hands, the wearer brings the mask to life. These graceful movements can captivate the viewer. If something is supposed to be hilarious, then you have to show that clearly, without speaking. You have to feel that yourself. Your body has to move in unison with the mask. In the world of Japan's traditional performing arts, masks play a crucial role. In Nō, the full range of human emotions is expressed through dance. An actor uses minimal, high-precision movements to convey subtle shifts in mental state. This is made possible by delicate crafting of the Nō mask. No makes use of various female masks. Young women, fearsome crones, pure celestial maidens. There are more than 20 kinds of female mask, each made for a specific character type. This mask represents a young woman. Look closely and you can see that the left and right sides are not exactly the same. The nostril on the right side is slightly lower, and the area around the mouth is clearly shaped. The nostril on the left flares up, and the area below the cheek is slightly different. The two sides of the face are subtly differentiated to let the performer express both the woman's strength and charm. And if you change the angle of the no mask, again its expression will change. Head-on, the expression is relatively neutral, but tilting the chin up makes the face seem happier. And when the chin is lowered, the face appears sadder. Such slight movements can make the eyes convey very different frames of mind. Whether at a festival or on the stage, there are literally so many faces to Japanese masks. Just look at all these masks. Some represent deities, others animals. A grinning mask. The mask of a wicked fox spirit. Japanese masks are very diverse. Since the old days, people in Japan have put on masks and danced to pray for a good harvest. In the world of traditional performing arts, masks are essential props that are passed down for generations. The history of masks in Japan dates back almost 2,000 years. Japanese masks are subtle and expressive, the products of exquisite craftsmanship. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we look at masks, whose timeless power to fascinate is deeply woven into the fabric of Japanese life.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Our theme for this week is masks, and I'm in Kyoto, where the first masks were made for the traditional no theater. The fantasy appeal of turning yourself into someone else runs deep in human nature, and a mask is something that can give you a new identity almost immediately. It can even transform you into something supernatural or superhuman. But today we're not going to be looking at superhero masks, rather the traditional Japanese masks that have been part of the culture here for hundreds of years.
Every community in Japan has festivals, and these frequently involve masks. People put on masks of deities or demons and dance to pray for a good harvest. The city of Hamada in Shimane Prefecture, Western Japan, is home to a festival with a long history. This dance is performed in thanksgiving for the bountiful blessings of the deities. The dancers conjure up a dazzling world of myth and magic. Many different gods and goddesses entertain the audience and draw them into the story that's presented. Ebisu, the god of prosperity in trade and business. Also considered the god of fishing, Ebisu is a popular object of worship. The bright colors of his mask emphasize his broad grin. Susanoo no Mikoto. This deity is said to have defeated the mythical eight-headed serpent. With his glaring eyes and clenched teeth, he looks pretty ferocious. The mask of a fox spirit, a troublemaker. In Japan, foxes are traditionally believed to possess supernatural powers. The mask excavated here is the earliest known wooden mask in Japanese history. It was carved out of a type of oak in the first half of the 3rd century. Scholars think it was used in rituals to avert disaster and to boost the harvest. Later, more sophisticated masks came to Japan from China. The collection of the Shosoin, Japan's preeminent treasure house in Nara, has masks dating back to the 8th century. This Paulownia wood mask would have been used by a child leading a lion in a lion dance. The expression is full of joy and vitality. From traces of pigment found on the lips and the tip of the nose, scholars have concluded that the face was originally covered in paint. This mask of a man's face is called Taikofu. He's a solitary old man with no family. The deep wrinkles on the forehead symbolize loneliness. Bugaku was a form of entertainment enjoyed at the imperial court 1,000 years ago. A performing art transmitted from China, Bugaku was frequently presented as an accompaniment to rituals. During the period of Chinese history called the Southern and Northern Dynasties, there lived a prince called Lan Ling. In battle, he would hide his beautiful face by wearing a fearsome mask surmounted by a dragon. His aim was to strengthen the resolve of his troops. The mask of Prince Lan Ling spread from Japan's imperial court to every corner of the land. In China, the dragon had the power to call up storm clouds and tempests. In Japan, it was associated mainly with plentiful rainfall. And that's why in many Japanese villages, masks of Prince Lan Ling came to be used in rituals where people pray for rain. A custom also developed of putting on masks and performing a dance, accompanied by taiko drums and flutes, when it was time to plant rice seedlings. The use of masks on these occasions is documented in picture scrolls. The No Theatre was synthesized from various performing arts in different parts of Japan. Zayami, the man who gave No a distinct identity, refined popular performance traditions into a sophisticated form of entertainment for warlords and the nobility. Color schemes fine-tuned in Japanese painting since the Heian period. Carving techniques developed in the Kamakura period. These were among the traditions harnessed to perfect No masks in the 16th century. Masks, first carved to assist in ancient harvest prayers, were refined over the centuries and eventually became a key element in one of Japan's classic performing arts.
Masks are not just a way to assume a role. In Japan, a mask is sacred and it can bring a character to life. But if a No actor fails to become one with his mask, it will have no dramatic impact. The connection is almost mystical, and No actors are extremely careful never to let anyone touch their masks.
The skin tone is created by applying several coats of paint over a period of a week. The pigments have been aged for 3 or 4 years and have soot added to them. This helps to create a color with depth. The maker of a No mask uses a variety of traditional techniques to endow the mask with the power to reflect subtle shades of human emotion. One moment brimming with anticipation, the next shy, and self-conscious.
This time I've come to a neighborhood called Higashiyama, which is well known for its antique shops. But I've actually come to visit a lady who makes no masks, who lives in this house here. So let's go straight in. Hello?
These are male masks on this side here and female masks on that side. You can tell them apart by looking at their hair. Female masks have their hair parted in the middle. These look very similar, but there are subtle differences. For instance, this is a girl 15 or 16 years old. And this one, a young woman between about 20 and 22 years old. And here, about the same age, but this one is a goddess. The lips are a little different. The lips on the other mask make her seem like she's smiling, but not so much on this mask here. This one's called Yamamba. She's an ogress who lives in the mountains. She's not a human being, so she has metal fittings in the eyes. And this is a Hannya mask. It represents a jealous female demon. A woman was so jealous, her face became like this.
I mean, they're all very realistic. This one particularly almost looks like he's alive.
This is Yase Otoko, an emaciated man. He's the ghost of someone who died with an unresolved grudge.
Depending on the angle you look at them from, they do really have very different expressions. This man here looks quite different.
Yes, it will vary depending on the angle.
If you say in Japanese that someone has a face like a no mask, it means that they're expressionless, but the expression really is down to the skill of the actor wearing the mask. Let's move on now and take a look at the history of masks in Japan.
Agricultural customs are deeply ingrained in Japanese culture. In ancient times, these customs gave rise to a variety of rituals and festivals, occasions to pray for and to give thanks for an abundant harvest. The harvest each year is greatly influenced by the weather. Accordingly, people appeal to the gods for good weather to grow rice. Many Japanese deities have strikingly human characteristics. By wearing various masks on religious occasions, people can assume the role of specific deities and dispense blessings. In Japan, masks date back almost 2,000 years. This is the Makimuku archaeological site in Nara Prefecture, Western Japan. Angle and sad from another. If the carver makes even the slightest error, the expression of the mask may be irreversibly altered. A skillful craftsman can breathe life into a mask. After the mask has been shaped, color is applied. One difficult task is to strike the right balance between the black lines of the eyes and hair and the pale tone of the skin. To achieve a deep black, India ink is mixed with aged soot. The red of the lipstick is given a tinge of blue to help the lips blend with the surrounding skin. Once a color has been applied, it's scraped with a bamboo tool, then applied again. This makes the color look more natural. The skin tone is created by applying several coats of paint over a period of a week. The pigments have been aged for 3 or 4 years and have soot added to them. This helps to create a color with depth. maker of a no mask uses a variety of traditional techniques to endow the mask with the power to reflect subtle shades of human emotion. One moment brimming with anticipation, the next shy and self-conscious.
This time I've come to a neighborhood called Higashiyama, which is well known for its antique shops. But I've actually come to visit a lady who makes no masks, who lives in this house here. So let's go straight in. Hello.
These are male masks on this side here and female masks on that side. You can tell them apart by looking at their hair. Female masks have their hair parted in the middle. These look very similar, but there are subtle differences. For instance, this is a girl 15 or 16 years old. And this one, a young woman between about 20 and 22 years old. Dynasties. There lived a prince called Lanling. In battle, he would hide his beautiful face by wearing a fearsome mask surmounted by a dragon. His aim was to strengthen the resolve of his troops. The mask of Prince Lanling spread from Japan's imperial court to every corner of the land. In China, the dragon had the power to call up storm clouds and tempests. In Japan, it was associated mainly with plentiful rainfall. And that's why in many Japanese villages, masks of Prince Lanling came to be used in rituals where people pray for rain. A custom also developed of putting on masks and performing a dance, accompanied by taiko drums and flutes, when it was time to plant rice seedlings. The use of masks on these occasions is documented in picture scrolls. The No Theatre was synthesized from various performing arts in different parts of Japan. Zayami, the man who gave No a distinct identity, refined popular performance traditions into a sophisticated form of entertainment for warlords and the nobility. Color schemes fine-tuned in Japanese painting since the Heian period. Carving techniques developed in the Kamakura period. These were among the traditions harnessed to perfect no masks in the 16th century. Masks, first carved to assist in ancient harvest prayers, were refined over the centuries and eventually became a key element in one of Japan's classic performing arts.
Masks are not just a way to assume a role. In Japan, a mask is sacred and it can bring a character to life. But if a no actor fails to become one with his mask, it will have no dramatic impact. The connection is almost mystical, and no actors are extremely careful never to let anyone touch their masks. Many masks are treasured to this day. Next, we're going to take a look at some completely different kinds of masks. This is a story about some people on a small island in western Japan and their efforts to keep alive a mask tradition in their community.
Okinoshima is part of Shimane Prefecture in western Japan. Far offshore in the Sea of Japan, this island has a rich cultural and archaeological heritage. But not long ago, it was hit by tragedy. The main hall of the temple Kokubunji. The red of the lipstick is given a tinge of blue to help the lips blend with the surrounding skin. Once a color has been applied, it's scraped with a bamboo tool, then applied again. This makes the color look more natural. A Chinese god, Shorky, drives away demons. The mask conveys Shorky's strength and his dignity. Here is one of Shoki's victims, a spirit that brings sickness. What is good and what is evil? The masks make the distinction clear. In ancient Japan, people believed in a multitude of different deities, and many of them can still be seen at Japanese festivals. These friendly-looking characters are Hyotoko and Okami. They have been familiar faces at festivals for centuries. In parts of Japan, Hyotoko is a god of fire. He breathes flames through his puckered mouth. This plump, happy woman is Okami. She is a deity of good fortune. As soon as a mask is in place, a skillful performer can reveal its powers of communication. Daikokuten, a god who brings wealth. With deft use of the arms and hands, the wearer brings the mask to life. These graceful movements can captivate the viewer. If something is supposed to be hilarious, then you have to show that clearly, without speaking. You have to feel that yourself. Your body has to move in unison with the mask. In the world of Japan's traditional performing arts, masks play a crucial role. In No, the full range of human emotions is expressed through dance. An actor uses minimal, high-precision movements to convey subtle shifts in mental state. This is made possible by delicate crafting of the No mask. No makes use of various female masks with the power to reflect subtle shades of human emotion. One moment, brimming with anticipation. The next, shy and self-conscious.
This time I've come to a neighborhood called Higashiyama, which is well known for its antique shops. But I've actually come to visit a lady who makes no masks, who lives in this house here. So let's go straight in. Hello.
These are male masks on this side here and female masks on that side. You can tell them apart by looking at their hair. Female masks have their hair parted in the middle. These look very similar, but there are subtle differences. For instance, this is a girl 15 or 16 years old. And this one, a young woman between about 20 and 22 years old. And here, about the same age, but this one is a goddess. The lips are a little different. The lips on the other mask make her seem like she's smiling, but not so much on this mask here. This one's called Yamamba. She's an ogress who lives in the mountains. She's not a human being, so she has metal fittings in the eyes. And this is a Hannya mask. It represents a jealous female demon. A woman was so jealous, her face became like this.
I mean, they're all very realistic. This one particularly almost looks like he's alive.
This is Yaseyotoko, an emaciated man. He's the ghost of someone who died with an unresolved grudge.
Depending on the angle you look at them from, they do really have very different expressions. This man here looks quite different.
Yes, it will vary depending on the angle.
If you say in Japanese that someone has a face like a no mask, it means that they're expressionless, but the expression really is down to the skill of the actor wearing the mask. Let's move on now and take a look at the history of masks in Japan.
Agricultural customs are deeply ingrained in Japanese culture. In ancient times, these customs gave rise to a variety of rituals and festivals, occasions to pray for and to give thanks for an abundant harvest. The harvest each year is greatly influenced by the weather. Accordingly, people appeal to the gods for good weather to grow rice. Many Japanese...
the traditional no theater. The fantasy appeal of turning yourself into someone else runs deep in human nature, and a mask is something that can give you a new identity almost immediately. It can even transform you into something supernatural or superhuman. But today we're not going to be looking at superhero masks, rather the traditional Japanese masks that have been part of the culture here for hundreds of years.
Every community in Japan has festivals, and these frequently involve masks. People put on masks of deities or demons and dance to pray for a good harvest. The city of Hamada in Shimane Prefecture, Western Japan, is home to a festival with a long history. This dance is performed in thanksgiving for the bountiful blessings of the deities. The dancers conjure up a dazzling world of myth and magic. Many different gods and goddesses entertain the audience and draw them into the story that's presented. Ebisu, the god of prosperity in trade and business. Also considered the god of fishing, Ebisu is a popular object of worship. The bright colors of his mask emphasize his broad grin. Susano no Mikoto. This deity is said to have defeated the mythical eight-headed serpent. With his glaring eyes and clenched teeth, he looks pretty ferocious. The mask of a fox spirit, a troublemaker. In Japan, foxes are traditionally believed to possess supernatural powers. A Chinese god, Shorky, drives away demons. The mask conveys Shorky's strength and his dignity. Here is one of Shorky's victims, a spirit that brings sickness. What is good and what is evil? The masks make the distinction clear. In ancient Japan, people believed in a multitude of different deities, and many of them can still be seen at Japanese festivals. These friendly-looking characters are Hyotoko and Okami. We look at masks, whose timeless power to fascinate is deeply woven into the fabric of Japanese life.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Our theme for this week is masks, and I'm in Kyoto, where the first masks were made for the traditional no theater. The fantasy appeal of turning yourself into someone else runs deep in human nature, and a mask is something that can give you a new identity almost immediately. It can even transform you into something supernatural or superhuman. But today we're not going to be looking at superhero masks, rather the traditional Japanese masks that have been part of the culture here for hundreds of years.
Every community in Japan has festivals, and these frequently involve masks. People put on masks of deities or demons and dance to pray for a good harvest. The city of Hamada in Shimane Prefecture, Western Japan, is home to a festival with a long history. This dance is performed in thanksgiving for the bountiful blessings of the deities. The dancers conjure up a dazzling world of myth and magic. Many different gods and goddesses entertain the audience and draw them into the story that's presented. Ebisu, Ebisu, the god of prosperity in trade and business. Also considered the god of fishing, Ebisu is a popular object of worship. The bright colors of his mask emphasize his broad grin. Susanoo no Mikoto. This deity is said to have defeated the mythical eight-headed serpent. With his glaring eyes and clenched teeth, he looks pretty ferocious. The mask of a fox spirit, a troublemaker. In Japan, foxes are traditionally believed to possess supernatural powers. A mask excavated here is the earliest known wooden mask in Japanese history. It was carved out of a type of oak in the first half of the 3rd century. Scholars think it was used in rituals to avert disaster and to boost the harvest. Later, more sophisticated masks came to Japan from China. These graceful movements can captivate the viewer. If something is supposed to be hilarious, then you have to show that clearly, without speaking. You have to feel that yourself. Your body has to move in unison with the mask. In the world of Japan's traditional performing arts, masks play a crucial role. In No, the full range of human emotions is expressed through dance. An actor uses minimal, high-precision movements to convey subtle shifts in mental state. This is made possible by delicate crafting of the No mask. No makes use of various female masks. Young women, fearsome crones, pure celestial maidens. There are more than 20 kinds of female mask, each made for a specific character type. This mask represents a young woman. Look closely and you can see that the left and right sides are not exactly the same. The nostril on the right side is slightly lower, and the area around the mouth is clearly shaped. The nostril on the left flares up, and the area below the cheek is slightly different. The two sides of the face are subtly differentiated to let the performer express both the woman's strength and charm. And if you change the angle of the No mask, again its expression will change. Head on, the expression is relatively neutral. But tilting the chin up makes the face seem happier. And when the chin is lowered, the face appears sadder. Such slight movements can make the eyes convey very different frames of mind. Whether at a festival or on the stage, there are literally so many faces to Japanese masks.
I'm in the Arashiyama area of Kyoto now, which is a popular tourist spot. This shop here specializes in bamboo products. They have some pretty interesting masks inside as well, so let's go in and take a look. These masks are known as Saga masks, Saga being the name of this district of Kyoto, and these masks have been made here for hundreds of years now. Let's take a look at one. This is Ebisu, who's one of the seven lucky gods.
The city of Hamada in Shimane Prefecture, Western Japan, is home to a festival with a long history. This dance is performed in thanksgiving for the bountiful blessings of the deities. The dancers conjure up a dazzling world of myth and magic. Many different gods and goddesses entertain the audience and draw them into the story that's presented. Ebisu, the god of prosperity in trade and business. Also considered the god of fishing, Ebisu is a popular object of worship. The bright colors of his mask emphasize his broad grin. Susano no Mikoto. This deity is said to have defeated the mythical eight-headed serpent. With his glaring eyes and clenched teeth, he looks pretty ferocious. The mask of a fox spirit, a troublemaker. In Japan, foxes are traditionally believed to possess supernatural powers. A Chinese god, Shorky, drives away demons. The mask conveys Shorky's strength and his dignity. Here is one of Shorky's victims, a spirit that brings sickness. What is good and what is evil? The masks make the distinction clear. In ancient Japan, people believed in a multitude of different deities, and many of them can still be seen at Japanese festivals. These friendly-looking characters are Hyotoko and Okami. They have been familiar faces at festivals for centuries. In parts of Japan, Hyotoko is a god of fire. He breathes flames through his puckered mouth. This plump, happy woman is Okami. She is a deity of good fortune. As soon as a mask is in place, a skillful performer can reveal its powers of communication. Daikokuten, a god who brings wealth. With deft use of the arms and hands, the wearer brings the mask to life.
Let's go straight in. Hello?
These are male masks on this side here and female masks on that side. You can tell them apart by looking at their hair. Female masks have their hair parted in the middle. These look very similar, but there are subtle differences. For instance, this is a girl 15 or 16 years old. And this one, a young woman between about 20 and 22 years old. And here, about the same age, but this one is a goddess. The lips are a little different. The lips on the other mask make her seem like she's smiling, but not so much on this mask here. This one's called Yamamba. She's an ogress who lives in the mountains. She's not a human being, so she has metal fittings in the eyes. And this is a Hannya mask. It represents a jealous female demon. A woman was so jealous, her face became like this.
I mean, they're all very realistic. This one particularly almost looks like he's alive.
This is Yaseyotoko, an emaciated man. He's the ghost of someone who died with an unresolved grudge.
Depending on the angle you look at them from, they do really have very different expressions. This man here looks quite different.
Yes, it will vary depending on the angle.
If you say in Japanese that someone has a face like a no mask, it means that they're expressionless, but the expression really is down to the skill of the actor wearing the mask. Let's move on now and take a look at the history of masks in Japan.
Agricultural customs are deeply ingrained in Japanese culture. In ancient times, these customs gave rise to a variety of rituals and festivals, occasions to pray for and to give thanks for an abundant harvest. The harvest each year is greatly influenced by the weather. Accordingly, people appeal to the gods for good weather to grow rice. Many Japanese deities have strikingly human characteristics. By wearing various masks on religious occasions, people can assume the role of specific deities and dispense blessings. In Japan, masks. The history of masks in Japan dates back almost 2,000 years. Japanese masks are subtle and expressive, the products of exquisite craftsmanship. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we look at masks, whose timeless power to fascinate is deeply woven into the fabric of Japanese life.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Our theme for this week is masks, and I'm in Kyoto, where the first masks were made for the traditional no theater. The fantasy appeal of turning yourself into someone else runs deep in human nature, and a mask is something that can give you a new identity almost immediately. It can even transform you into something supernatural or superhuman. But today we're not going to be looking at superhero masks, rather the traditional Japanese masks that have been part of the culture here for hundreds of years.
Every community in Japan has festivals, and these frequently involve masks. People put on masks of deities or demons and dance to pray for a good harvest. The city of Hamada in Shimane Prefecture, Western Japan, is home to a festival with a long history. This dance is performed in thanksgiving for the bountiful blessings of the deities. The dancers conjure up a dazzling world of myth and magic. Many different gods and goddesses entertain the audience and draw them into the story that's presented. Ebisu, the god of prosperity in trade and business. Also considered the god of fishing, Ebisu is a popular object of worship. The bright colors of his mask emphasize his broad grin. Susano no Mikoto. This deity is said to have defeated the mythical eight-headed serpent. With his glaring eyes and clenched teeth, he looks pretty ferocious. The mask of a fox spirit, a troublemaker. In Japan, foxes are traditionally believed to possess supernatural powers. Color look more natural. The skin tone is created by applying several coats of paint over a period of a week. The pigments have been aged for 3 or 4 years and have soot added to them. This helps to create a color with depth. The maker of a no mask uses a variety of traditional techniques to endow the mask with the power to reflect subtle shades of human emotion. One moment brimming with anticipation, the next shy and self-conscious.
This time I've come to a neighborhood called Higashiyama, which is well known for its antique shops. But I've actually come to visit a lady who makes no masks, who lives in this house here. So let's go straight in. Hello.
These are male masks on this side here and female masks on that side. You can tell them apart by looking at their hair. Female masks have their hair parted in the middle. These look very similar, but there are subtle differences. For instance, this is a girl 15 or 16 years old. and this one a young woman between about 20 and 22 years old. And here, about the same age, but this one is a goddess. The lips are a little different. The lips on the other mask make her seem like she's smiling, but not so much on this mask here. This one's called Yamamba. She's an ogress who lives in the mountains. She's not a human being, so she has metal fittings in the eyes. And this is a Hannya mask. It represents a jealous female demon. A woman was so jealous, her face became like this.
I mean, they're all very realistic. This one particularly almost looks like he's alive.
This is Yaseyotoko, an emaciated man. He's the ghost of someone who died with an unresolved grudge.
Depending on the angle you look at them from, they do really have very different expressions. This man here looks quite different.
Yes, it will vary depending on the angle.
If you say in Japanese that someone has a face like a no mask, it means that they're expressionless, but the expression really is down to the skill of the